So welcome everyone, bienvenidos, how are you doing? Oh, that is the weakest response. And it's my first time in San Antonio. Step it up a bit, I know it's early in the morning. How are you doing? Alright, we're gonna have some fun today. This presentation is called Engaging Latinos in San Antonio. You might notice I put up both my Twitter handle, Matthew P. Adler, and a hashtag that I made. Generally, it's good to make short hashtags, but guess what? SA Engage and SA Latinos are already taken. So we have SA Engage Latinos, which is very specific, right? So feel free to be tweeting before, after. I'll get back to tweets later this afternoon and this week. Let's share our knowledge with each other, because even though I'm up here telling you my experience, I want to hear about your experience too and give you the opportunity to share with each other. And Twitter is one way to do that. So, nuestra agenda, we got three things on our agenda today. I'm going to move around a little bit. Who are Latinos? We're going to talk about demographics. We're going to talk about language use. And digital engagement. Digital engagement is very, 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 very important for the Latino community. And as you'll learn today, it is more important for the Latino community than any other community in the US. So digital is going to be really important. If that's one takeaway you get from here today, if you want to engage with Latinos, digital has to be a part of the picture. We're going to talk about how we can engage. So I want this to be useful for you, right? I don't want to just give you a bunch of demographic information. That's important. But I want you to be able to have actual takeaways. I want you to have online outreach tips. We said digital was important. How do you do it, right? Advocacy strategies. And certainly we're gonna do two case studies today about how to engage Latinos and how to engage in advocacy work. Lastly, we're gonna have some next steps. We're gonna have concrete takeaways that you can bring home with you today. I believe Scott emailed this presentation to everyone, or is going to, so you'll have access to all these slides. And I want you to take that home and use it. This is very practical stuff. And we're going to do a little role play to practice what we've learned today. How's that sound, everyone?
Good.
Good. Okay, I like that. Thank you for the applause. So who am I, and why am I here? So I'm here to talk to you about Latino outreach, because that's what I do. I'm the president of Matt Adler Strategies. My partner came up with the adorable acronym MAS, Matt Adler Strategies, MAS, okay? I was thinking for like weeks and weeks when I started my business what to call it, and I was like, oh, maybe Matt Adler Strategies, and Peter, my partner, said, yeah, MAS. Oh, so that's my company. I'm multilingual, actually. I'm working on my eighth language, but in terms of my work for my company, right now it's in English, Spanish, or both, and I'm fully bilingual. I specifically focus on cause communication. Who knows what cause communication is? Because it's probably what most of you do, but maybe not realize. Anyone? Cause communications is about using communications to promote a certain issue or cause. It is, for example, very different from communications at, BP, right? It's a big corporation. That's not cause communications. It's still communications, but cause communications is what nonprofits do, right? And it's what I help nonprofits do. It's to promote your issue, promote your cause, connect you to your community. I only work with nonprofits or socially conscious businesses. That's just what I do. I have a lot of experience working with the Latino community. I worked at Mandev. Anyone familiar with Mandev? They have an office here in San Antonio. It's the Mexican American Legal Defense and Educational Fund. It's a long name, that's why I call it Mandev. I also worked with Casa de Maryland in the DC area doing legal intakes for immigrants. So I would help immigrants, usually coming in Spanish, and help them with legal issues and refer them to lawyers. I've done mentorship programs with Latino youth, both in St. Louis and in Washington, D.C., to help connect them with educational opportunities, help them with school, help them navigate the educational system, and relate to their parents as well and bring them in on the process. And I also work teaching English for people's citizenship exams, primarily to Latino groups. So these are just some examples. There are some other ones out there, but I've been involved with this community for many years, and I'm very proud of my work with it. So I want to know a little bit about you, because it's not all about me today. It's really about you. So, by a show of hands, how many of you live in the city of San Antonio? So, almost everyone. Anyone not in San Antonio, like maybe outside the city? Okay, we got a few. How many of your nonprofits are centered specifically in San Antonio? So, majority, and how about not? A few, good, okay. And, because we're gonna be talking about some of the counties outside San Antonio, some of the excerpts, right? So we're not just gonna be talking about the city today, though it's primarily about the city. How many of you work in a communications role? And how many of you work in another role at your organization? Okay. How many of you, either for work or outside of work, have engaged in outreach to the Latino community? So about half? About half? Okay. And how many of you, you want to learn about it because you haven't done it before? Okay. Good. So thanks for sharing with me. It gives me a sense of where you're at and where to focus on for today. So here's a little quiz. Pregunta número uno. Are there more Latinos in Texas? We'll do this by a show of hands. Texas or Honduras? So who thinks Texas? And how about Honduras? The correct answer is Texas by about 500,000, which is crazy. Because Honduras is, everyone speaks Spanish. It's an entire Latin American country, but there are more Latinos just in this state than in Honduras, which gives you a sense of why this is so important, right? Second question. What are the first and second states in the United States in terms of Latino population size, the number of Latinos that live in those states? I'll just take a, you know, individual guesses.
California
and Texas, right? So Texas is number 2 out of 50. Pretty important. Which language has more native speakers in the world? English or Spanish? Native speakers meaning they grew up with it as their first language. Spanish by several hundred million. The estimates vary by about 150 to 200 million more people speak Spanish globally as a native language. So we're talking about a big gap there. A lot of English speakers learn it as a second language globally. But in terms of core population that speaks it natively, Spanish is one of the largest. But let's talk about the United States now for a second. We're going to gradually get smaller and smaller until we're talking about San Antonio specifically. But let's talk about the U.S. So Latinos are the largest minority group. There are different ways to define minority, but for our purposes today, they're the largest minority group in the U.S. It's worth considering that there's overlap between minority groups. You can be Black and Latino, just ask a Dominican, okay? So, but for the purposes of today, they're the largest minority group. They're expected to be a third of the U.S. by 2060. So if you're not reaching out to them now, you're missing out. And you're going to miss out more with every consecutive year. This is a really important population. Over a third of Latinos were born in another country. However, as immigration is not as high now as it was even a decade ago or 5 years ago before the financial collapse, increasingly the growth rate is driven by natural growth, which is the birth rate here in the United States. There are 53 million Latinos in the U.S., and if you compare that to every other Spanish-speaking country, the only Spanish-speaking country with more Spanish speakers is Mexico. Think about that for a second. Argentina, Spain. We have more Spanish speakers than Spain in the United States. I think it's a pretty interesting statistic. In the U.S. as a whole, about two-thirds are of Mexican origin. And by the way, there are different ways to explain Mexican origin. What are different words that you've heard to describe people of Mexican-American descent? Because there are different ones in Spanish and English. Anyone? Hispanic, Chicano. What about in Texas specifically? Tejano. Right? So we're just putting that together in one category, but realize people may use different labels, right? People may use different labels to explain their identity. But you have to know that even with a majority of Latinos in the United States being Mexican-American, you do have concentrated minorities from other places. In South Florida, where I worked in 2008 for the Obama campaign, There's a huge Cuban community, huge Puerto Rican community, and if you go to New York, you have a huge Dominican community, Puerto Rican community. So you really need to know your market. I'm from D.C. The largest Latino group in D.C. is Salvadoran, by a lot, right? So you really need to know who you're reaching out to, because everyone has different needs depending on where they come from, and speaks differently, and engages differently. And you can see that big chart. It'll be easier to see when you have the slideshow on your computer, but this is a really interesting chart breaking down all the different nationalities of Latinos in the 2012 in the United States. If you look at the lower right-hand corner, I wish I had a little laser thingy, it says Pew Research Center. That's a great resource. The Pew Research Center is a nonprofit based in DC. They research a whole bunch of things, oceans and demography and Latinos and everything in between, but they have a Pew Hispanic Center. They have lots of good data. So it's a really good source, in addition to the census, which we'll get to later, for researching the Latino community to know your audience before you reach out to it. So look at this demographic picture, literally picture. Got a graph. This kind of puts a visual image, right, to what we were talking about just a few minutes ago. Look at the increase from 1970 to today, which would, you know, kind of be between 2010 and 2020. And where it's headed, right? So this is a rapidly growing community, and their importance is growing not only in Texas, but nationwide, but especially in Texas. And as you'll see, the source of this data was the U.S. Census Bureau, which also has a lot of great information. If you're trying to research the Latino community, get to know the community, you can actually buy census tracts, which is like, who knows what a census tract is? So what's a census tract? Right, and it's like, it's a specific little sliver of land. I mean, much smaller than a county, right? Like a neighborhood. You can go by neighborhood and find out the ethnic composition of that neighborhood, the financial situation of that neighborhood. I mean, all the information you need to be successful in making outreach to any community, but of course to the Latino community as well. So I'm a big fan of the Census Bureau, but we'll talk about some of the issues with their categories in a little bit. So where do they live? Who got this question right earlier? Only 5 of you? I don't believe that. That Texas was number 2 in the country for Latino population? More of you got it. Give yourself some credit. So Texas is number 2. You can see there's a big gap. Once you get past California and Texas, Florida is less than half of the population of Texas when it comes to the Latino community. So Texas is really a heavy hitter. You should be proud. And you can also see that in terms of the percent makeup of the U.S. population, the U.S. Latino population, California is going down a little bit. It's still going up in numbers, but relative to the rest of the U.S., it's going down. Texas is holding steady. So that's what's on the chart over there on the right. But let's talk about your city. Who cares about the rest of the U.S.? Your city is growing really fast. Not just for Latinos, just in general, it is growing really fast. 16% growth between 2000 and 2010, which made it the 3rd fastest growing city in the entire country, okay? And this is during an economic recession that this happened. So it's pretty impressive. A majority of the city is Latino, and that is almost twice the amount of the state as a whole. So if Texas is already an important, as we saw, an important place for the Latino community, San Antonio is like twice as important. So you're twice as important as the rest of Texas. Because I know Texans don't have rivalries, right? No, not at all. And so it's important to understand, and some of you probably already know this, what really makes the Latino community in San Antonio unique is that while, yes, there is a significant portion of the community that may be newly arrived immigrants, there is also a portion of the community that's been here for a long time. And in fact, as you know, this was part of Mexico. And before that, this was part of Spain. And before that, Native American, right? So the point is, there have been Latinos in this area for a long, long time before it was even part of the United States. And you can't say that for other Latino communities. Not in Washington, D.C., not in New York. That is unique to this part of the country. So don't take that for granted. It definitely will impact the way that you do your outreach because you have a different community here. So more about the demographics of Latinos in San Antonio. An even higher percentage of Latinos in San Antonio are of Mexican descent than the rest of the country, right? So what was the percentage, I'm not gonna quiz you, I'm not gonna grade you, right? But what was the percentage, does anyone remember, of Mexican Americans in the Latino population for the country as a whole? Yeah, it was about 2/3. Very good. Oh, cheater. No cheating, no cheating. Yeah, so, but you know, you can see that it is a predominantly Mexican American community, and that's important to know. Because if you're not already familiar with this, and even within Spanish speakers, there's a significant difference between Mexican Spanish, Argentinian Spanish, Spanish from Spain, Spanish from El Salvador. So you need to know where people are coming from. It's not just an interesting statistic. It'll influence everything from website translation to social media and everything in between. That being said, there are minorities of other Latino groups in this area, especially brought here by the military, including Cubans and Puerto Ricans and other groups. So it's not just Mexican Americans, but you need to know who you're reaching out to, and that'll influence the way that you do it. Because everything goes back to audience. And we'll talk about this later. Everything goes back to audience. You have to identify your audience before you do your outreach. And if your audience is Mexican American, then that will help guide what you do. It'll influence what organizations you reach out to. It'll influence the type of content you put up. But if you are focusing, for example, on Latinos that might have moved to this area for the military and might be of Caribbean descent, then that is also going to change your outreach, change the vocabulary you use to reach this community. So here's a snapshot with a beautifully crafted family photo. love that stock imagery, right? How long do you think they were smiling for that? So you have the percentages that we just talked about. What's interesting is the last statistic. So over about 14% of the Latino community in San Antonio does not identify as Mexican American or even another nationality, right? So there could be, for example, mixed couples, right? Maybe mama is Mexican American, but papa is Puerto Rican. And maybe they don't identify with any of these particular categories. So that's something to be aware of as well. So, the majority of the San Antonio area lives in Bexar County. Scott had to teach me how to say that name because who speaks Spanish? ¿Quién habla español? Okay, how would you say the name of this county in Spanish? Yeah. Right, so I emailed Scott and I was looking at some of the counties like, Comal County? It's Comal, right? But I speak Spanish, so I'm looking at them, I say, I think I know how to say these, but I'm gonna make sure, and I didn't realize that I didn't know how to say them. So Bexar County, am I saying it right? Okay, Bexar County, it's a majority, but you do have exurbs, what I like to call exurbs. Is everyone familiar with that term? We have a lot of them in the DC area. It's kind of like a suburb plus, like a little bit further than a suburb. And so it's not quite rural, but it's not quite suburban. And you have some counties like that here that are not right in the city, but you have growing populations. In Guadalupe County, I think you all kept the Spanish with that, right? Guadalupe County, and Comal County, But what's interesting about these counties is that they actually have significant Latino populations, which I think some people might find surprising. Because at least in the DC area, we associate exurbs, those far out suburbs, with really predominantly white areas. But that's not entirely the case here. With both of these counties, it's over 20% Latino. So if you're thinking about Latino outreach, you need to be thinking about surrounding counties as well. So here are my words of caution. Dun, dun, dun. Okay? I talked about the Census Bureau. It's a great website. It's easy to get to, census.gov. I talked about the Pew Hispanic Center. Also a great resource. They probably have a longer URL. Here's the thing about that. With the census, and I actually did census outreach for MONDEF in 2010, so I'm very familiar with this topic. The census does not consider Latino a race. However, for many Latinos, that is their primary identification. So it creates a very confusing situation, because racial identity in the Latino community is very fluid. It's not the same categories as in the US. But we're putting a US category on top of something that doesn't quite fit with that model. So what happens is, because Latinos are forced to choose both the race and separately whether they are Latino or not on the census form, many Latinos say, okay, white, even if that's not how they would really refer to themselves on a daily basis. So if you look on the census data, be really careful with this, because if you're not looking at Hispanic origin, it looks like San Antonio is 80-90% white, which it obviously is not how most people here would define themselves. So be careful when you're looking at San Antonio, when you're looking at these neighboring counties, to look at Hispanic origin. That's what it's called on the census, Latino or Hispanic origin. And it's a separate category from race. And it's very controversial, because some Latinos, Latinos have different identities, and sometimes multiple identities. We talked about Dominicans in New York, for example. Well, a lot of Dominicans have a lot of African ancestry, and so they'll say, yes, I'm Latino, but I also have an African identity, an African ancestry. And how does that compare to, for example, a mestizo, like a Latino who has indigenous ancestry, Native American ancestry, and European ancestry? I think the census data is useful, so I'm not trying to tell you don't use it. I'm just saying take it with a grain of salt, because it's a complicated issue and it doesn't fit neatly into boxes. It does not fit neatly into boxes. So language. Language is really important. In general, I love languages. Okay? It's the way we communicate with people. It's the way we make ourselves understood. It's the way we reach out to people. It's a way of building connections. And what I've found with languages, and with all the languages I speak, is it brings me new friendships. And you'll see why I'm saying this. It brings me new friendships. It brings me new insight. It brings me a new awareness about the world. And that's why I value learning languages. Because when you speak to someone in their native language, it's different. Who here has studied another language or speaks another language besides English? So when you speak to someone in that language, who grew up speaking that language, I found that the connection is warmer. The connection is stronger. There's more clarity. And that's not to say that you can't speak to people in English in the Latino community. That's not what I'm saying. But for the people who especially are either immigrants or grew up speaking Spanish, it has a special meaning. It has a special significance for them. And when you reach out to people and meet them where they are, as opposed to expecting them to come speak what you're speaking, it signals respect. And that's really important. Because if you can't do outreach without respect. And so here are some statistics to give you an idea of what's going on with language in the Latino community. 74% of Latinos speak Spanish at home. That's nationwide. It may be even higher in Texas. And you can find those statistics on the census website. So, you know, I just want to point that out because, yes, many Latinos are bilingual. Yeah, especially second, third generation may even only speak English or some Spanish, right, which we'll talk about in a second. However, pay attention to the first statistic. 74% of Latinos speak Spanish at home. If you're not doing any content in Spanish, you're probably missing some of the Latino community. I think that's very safe to say. It's very important. Because if you're speaking it at home, that means it's daily use. It's very important to your family, and it's the primary mode of communication, even if when you go to school, you're speaking English. So it's still an important language. And you can be bilingual and still prefer to use one language over the other, which is important to consider. You know, for those of you who are native English speakers and studied another language, how many of you would prefer your medical information in English? I speak 8 languages. I still prefer my medical information in English. I have a French doctor, and I speak to him in English because I don't want to miss anything, okay? It's the doctor. It's one thing if it's a friend or I'm at a restaurant or anything like that, but I'm not missing my medical information because I missed a verb in French. Okay, so similarly, you may have Latinos who speak some or even very strong English, but some people might still prefer Spanish because that's what's comfortable with them, right? That's what they have the best command of. 90% of Latinos born in the U.S. speak English very well, so you do see a shift. Sorry, I think it's kind of sad, but you do see a shift towards almost monolingual English speaking as more generations live in the U.S. I'm all for multilingualism, you know, so I think we can speak multiple languages, but unfortunately, with the situation it is in the U.S. today, more and more Latinos, as they spend more generations in the U.S., often lose Spanish, right? However, some of those Latinos born in the U.S. are also speaking Spanish. So it's important to understand that these statistics are not mutually exclusive. Right, you can have overlap. 68% of U.S. Latinos born abroad do not speak English very well. This again gets to my point. You can speak some English, but still prefer Spanish. Especially if you're an immigrant to this country, you grew up speaking Spanish. And so you are going to rely on that more for that medical information, for that social services information. For a lot of the issues that you work on that are complicated, people might feel more comfortable seeing it in Spanish because that's what they know best. Just like you would for your native language. And this statistic is bolded and in yellow, just so you can see very clearly, okay? 42.5% of all San Antonians, like not the Latino community, but everyone in the San Antonio area speaks Spanish at home. That's huge. That's probably one of the highest numbers of any American city. And so what that means is, if you're not reaching out to the Latino community in any form in Spanish, you're missing about half the market in the San Antonio area. It'd be like going to Montreal and not doing anything in French. It's about the same statistic. It's about half the city is native French speakers in Montreal. And no one would ever think to do that, right? Because obviously half the city speaks French. You have to have material in French. But so what I'm trying to encourage you is, even if you haven't done this yet, and that's okay, consider putting out content, putting out resources in Spanish, because a lot of the San Antonio area speaks that at home. That's from the Census Bureau. I will, at the end of the presentation, there's a slide with some of the resources that I use. But I'm happy to also send you, if you give me your card, I can send you the specific page that I got it from. But a lot of these are taken from the Census Bureau. At the end of the presentation, there are links to some of the statistics that I got. Yeah. Sure, the census, I don't believe, does that, though it's worth giving an extra shot. Here, I can tell you my estimate of that, is that the older the trends, the older the person, the more likely they are Spanish dominant. The younger or born in America, that means more likely to be bilingual or leaning towards English. If they are an immigrant, as opposed to being born here of any age, they're more likely to speak Spanish. So it's more about trends. I don't have a specific number breakdown for you, but I think those are the general trends. And so that will be important because if, for instance, your program is targeting young Latinos born in the US, then you'll know more likely to be bilingual or speak English. But if you're targeting the senior citizens, well, they're more likely to speak Spanish. Good question, yes. Yeah, it's a really good point, and I'm a linguistics dork, so I'm going to take 30 seconds and kind of delve into this. There are a lot of studies that show that students educated in two or more languages end up having more success in terms of academics, emotional success, you know, ability to regulate themselves emotionally, more mental flexibility, so that bilingualism and multilingualism is really an asset. And you can absolutely learn more than one language fluently. In France, you actually are required to learn two languages besides French. So I think in the United States, we have an idea that, well, you know, if you add a language, you have to take away a language, which is not how it works. Your brain is very flexible. I think there's stigma against speaking another language in the US. This goes back many generations. You know, my great-grandparents all spoke Yiddish, and I'm actually relearning it, which is exciting. But, you know, they were discouraged for many years from speaking their language, and that's why it faded. And I see a similar pattern happening with the Latino community being discouraged from speaking Spanish, when everyone knows everyone is perfectly capable of speaking Spanish and English. It's not an either-or thing. And so I think when you have those families, you have maybe, and I can send you some studies, encourage them to say bilingualism is an advantage, not a disadvantage. So I hope that answers your question. and we're gonna pause for questions in a few minutes too. So we'll take some more questions as we go. So we talked about languages, but what languages, right? You might say, well, yeah, English and Spanish. Well, there's also Spanglish. And speaking of languages or dialects that are definitely looked down by some people, Spanglish is one of them. And Spanglish is kind of broadly identified as a mixture of Spanish and English. And it's very common, especially with people who were born in the US, whose parents or grandparents speak Spanish, they may mix the languages. It's called code switching. You move from one to the next and back and forth, borrow a word here, it's fun. It's fun. I really enjoy it. When I worked at MALDEF, I learned a little bit. It was fun. Keeps your brain moving. And so, you know, again, that pattern that we were talking about, what was your name? Sandra. Sandra brought up a great point about what are the general trends? Well, the more generations they've been in the US, less Spanish, more English, we know that. But Spanglish is the part we didn't talk about before. And yeah, it's legit to use Spanglish on social media. It's a way of speaking. I'm not into judging different ways of speaking. It's another way of speaking that reflects the Latino experience in America, right? So, you know, not all Latinos are fully bilingual, which we covered earlier, but this is the key point in yellow again for your benefit. Know your audience before engaging. I can't tell you how many times, not just specific to Latino issues, but with any issue, some nonprofits just want to jump in. Who's had that experience? Where it's like, we haven't made a plan, we haven't researched, see, you know what I'm talking about, we're just going to jump in and throw some stuff and see what sticks. Don't do that. Especially with the Latino community, since it's so diverse, and such a rich heritage and complicated community. Don't just do, don't, it's like a dating technique that I had some friends that used this. It's called the hand grenade technique. You just throw it and hope it hits something. Don't do that. So know your audience before engaging. That's it. Do your research. Get to know who you want to reach out to. Who do you want your message to reach? And we talked about how the city is at least half Spanish speaking. So definitely consider Spanish for your content. I love this sign. Who can translate it?
23 flavors, limited to one extraordinary taste.
Yeah, say that again.
23 flavors blended into one extraordinary taste.
Inconfundible?
Not confused.
Yeah, can't be confused. Yeah. That's the best way that I would put it. So this is a Spanglish ad. So if you thought that Spanglish was just, oh, it's slang. No, it's entering. If Dr. Pepper is putting up ads in Spanglish, it's a real thing. Right? You got to think about that. Okay?
Matthew.
Yes. Explain more.
Tex-Mex, like I'm born here, but raised speaking Spanish, and I can speak English correctly and Spanish correctly, and I'll just go back and forth.
Yeah.
English, Spanish in one phrase or one sentence or conversation.
Absolutely. I have a similar experience with a friend from Puerto Rico. And in Puerto Rico, it's very common to say a full sentence in Spanish and then a full sentence in English and then a few words in Spanish and go back and forth and back and forth, and it's fun. I really enjoy it. But you really do need to understand both languages at times to be able to keep up, right? But it is, that's kind of what I'm broadly, that Tex-Mex is what I'm kind of broadly calling Spanish, but that's another way to call it. It's mixing the languages, right? Preguntas. So we're going to pause for a moment. I've talked a lot. We got more to do. Let's take some questions.
So it's not a question, it's a comment.
Sure.
About some Spanish-speaking parents wanting their kids only. I think part of that is the whole anti-immigrant, I'm going to say anti-Latino immigrant action. And then also in Texas, where, I don't know, generations before me, kids got in trouble for speaking Spanish at school. So it's the notion of, you know, being bilingual, but not with Spanish. That's not viewed as, because it's more of a racist, it's an anti-Latino.
And actually, it's interesting because this has happened with other communities in the U.S. For example, in Louisiana, where it used to be primarily French-speaking, up until like the 1960s, they would put soap in the kids' mouths if they spoke French, right? So there's a real movement of people who don't appreciate diversity, which is no one in this room. We all appreciate diversity. Who would say it's English, that's it. But we realize that we're in a diverse society and we need to respect each other and that multilingualism is a good thing, right? And so even if your organization is not multilingual, you can have multilingual outreach, you can build that program to reach the communities you want with respect, right? Meet them where they're at. Yes?
How do the statistics about speaking Spanish in the home translate to reading Spanish?
That's a good question. Some people who immigrate to the United States, for example, not just Latinos, but it could be from other parts of the globe, aren't necessarily literate in Spanish or in their respective languages. Some are. It depends on their level of education before they got here. So that will depend more on socioeconomic status. So I would say, generally speaking, if they came from a poor region, in a Latin American country or in Mexico, right, then there's a higher likelihood that they might not be able to read in Spanish. But I would still say this, is that even if they don't personally, if there's one member of the family who doesn't read in Spanish, there may be another family member who reads in Spanish that you can reach through them, right? So if they're speaking Spanish at home, it's still a primary language. And even if there's individuals who might not be able to read or write in Spanish, it's very likely that their spouse or their child or their uncle or their cousin would be able to get that material to them.
Because I can think of friends of mine who are educated and speak Spanish fluently. Many of them would say, well, I can't read a book in Spanish.
So you're talking about people born in the U.S.?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's part of the trend towards English. So there's two things there. There's one is people who might arrive and not be able to read and write in Spanish, but speak it fluently, right? The second is what you're talking about, which is people who were born in the U.S., but because they're more schooled in English as opposed to Spanish, they understand Spanish perfectly, but they don't read and write it. And those are two different populations. So I would suggest different outreach strategies for the two populations.
So you're saying there's always a value, if you know your market, to send a flyer home in English and Spanish.
Yeah, absolutely. Because there's going to be, what's the organization you work with?
San Antonio Sports.
Okay, yeah. So I mean, even, what often happens is that children will translate for their parents and grandparents. But something might get missed along the way. Who was always honest about the flyers they got home with their parents? I know I wasn't. So you wanna be able to reach the right audiences and not just be reliant on that kid to translate for mama and abuelita, and kind of share selective information with them.
Got it.
Más preguntas, more questions. We'll have more time later too, but feel free. All right, moving on. Let's get digital. Woo, we need some energy. It's been like an hour, we need some energy. Let's try it again, let's get digital. That's much better. Okay, I focus primarily on social media. I think it is a great way to connect with people. It's also, at times, a time suck, but it's also a great way to reach new communities. And I think that it's very important for you to understand that, you know, everyone knows that social media is important in general, but it is more important for reaching Latinos than anyone else in the U.S. And even in Latin America, as we'll see, it is more important because Latinos use social media more than the rest of the U.S. by 10%. Okay? So, if you're not Latino and you think you're on Facebook a lot, add 10%. Okay? So, they're using it more often. Facebook is the most popular in general for all communities in the U.S. However, because the Latino community trends younger than the rest of the population, Instagram and Twitter are more popular for Latinos than for Caucasians because those platforms trend younger. Right? Because let's be honest, who has children? Like, let's say teenagers? Yeah, okay. They're probably on Facebook with some sort of like bland profile, but the real action is happening on Twitter and Instagram and Snapchat and Snapchat and a bunch of other platforms that you probably don't know exist. So, get on them. But my point is because Latinos are younger, they're also more likely to be on those platforms. So that's something to consider, because it's not just social media, it's where on social media is my audience. Latinos are 35% more likely to follow a brand, could be replaced with nonprofit, on social media than the rest of the population. So it's not just that they're spending, it's not just that Latinos are on social media more, proportionally. It's not just that they're spending more time on social media, it's that they're also more active on social media. It's like a triple threat, right? But not a threat. Triple opportunity, right? It's really important to get this point. You can't move if you're not mobile, right? I thought that's clever. I know. That's what my partner says. I tell cheesy jokes all the time. Who likes puns? I love puns. I'm gonna interrupt and tell you a quick joke. This is my favorite joke in the world. What's Beethoven's favorite fruit? Banana. So, that's my sense of humor in one joke. He puts up with me. So let's go back to Latinos. Mobile devices are number one for Latinos. Number one. Many Latinos have a mobile device but don't necessarily have a laptop. Right? So they're accessing the internet via the mobile device more than computers. So when you're thinking even of putting stuff out on social media, on websites, for the Latino community, You should be thinking, how does this look on my phone? Not how does this look on my work computer? It's all about mobile. You know, Latinos are just as likely as the rest of the US to have a smartphone, right? So apps are big. I'm actually helping a client develop a Spanish language app because they were very popular. Look at that bottom statistic. 87% of Latinos, young Latinos, 18 to 29, use mobile for internet. That's almost everyone, okay? Almost everyone in that age demographic is using their mobile phones for internet. Yes?
I'm sorry, I'm going to ask another question about geriatrics. So when you're looking at 18 to 29 mobile users, what is that percentage for the older population, 65 and older?
I can get you the specific number, but what I will tell you is that, interestingly enough, the 65 and older demographic, even though they use social media at a lower rate than Latinos, they are the fastest growing demographic on social media. Yes. Yes. And so even though it's still smaller because young people are on social media all the time, but it is growing faster than any other group. 65 plus. If you look at Facebook statistics, 65 plus is the fastest growing group. They're catching, they want to see the pictures of their grandkids. No problem. All right. What about Latin America? We've talked about the US. Any of your organizations do any work in either Latin America or specifically Mexico across the border at all? Do you have any partnerships? No? Maybe considering them? Okay, but think about it. So the point is this matters in Latin America too, which also matters for the people coming from Latin America to the US, to San Antonio, right? Mexico is number one in Latin America when it comes to mobile devices. Number one. For smartphones specifically. It doubled just in 2012. The number of people who had mobile devices in Mexico doubled in a year, okay? And what's interesting here is, does anyone know what percentage of Americans, regardless of race or background, are using Facebook via mobile? Like on their phone. Anyone have a guess?
Primarily or exclusively?
At all.
90%?
The answer is about 50%. However, what's the statistic say up there for Mexico?
74.
They're using the heck out of Facebook, and it's on their phones, right? So that's important to know because you can actually, when you're posting to Facebook, you can see a preview of your post according to how it would appear on a mobile device. Your pictures, I mean, test it out on your phone. You want to see that your pictures, your links, and everything are appearing well on a mobile device if you're reaching the Latino community, whether it's in the US or abroad. Very important. And this is what, we'll get into this later, this is why be careful how much text you use. Not texting, but text on a post. Because, you know, who wants to read a big long paragraph on their phone? Nobody. I don't. I tune it out, right? But a beautiful picture with a few quick lines about what I need to know, I'm in. So watch the amount of text. Some organizations treat Facebook as an email mechanism. It's not an email. Don't make it the length of an email or people aren't going to read it. Especially because for the Latino community, it's on their phone. They don't want to read all that text. Keep it simple. Link elsewhere if necessary, but keep the post simple. And this is just a graph of what's going on in Mexico. I mean, you can see it's going up and up and up. It's going to continue going up. It's really astonishing. Look, over the course of 5 years, it's gone from 18.4 million people to what will be 54.4 million. It's huge. Or as Donald says, huge, right? He's not invited today. So, here we go. Mobile and social media means three things. It means images, good images, means video, and links. And why do these three things matter? Look at this post. First of all, ¿alguien puede traducir esto?
Broccoli is very healthy. It has fiber, proteins, and vitamins A and C.
And B6.
Oh, and B6.
Don't forget B6. No, that's excellent. Thank you for doing that. So this is a post for one of my clients that I did. You can see it did well. Look at the bottom. Okay? And it's just a piece of broccoli. Let's be honest, I love broccoli, but these people, 7,000 likes, really like broccoli. Okay? This post was not boosted 1 cent. Not 1 cent. Okay? Why is this a successful post? Just take a look at it. It's written well, it's in Spanish. What else?
Short.
Big one. What about the broccoli?
It looks good.
It looks, as broccoli goes, it looks really good. So, you know, in other words, they are giving increasing reach to videos that, not YouTube links, but videos that you embed in Facebook, you put directly on Facebook, they will help that perform better. Same thing with links. Links that, you know, you have an image that pops up when you put the link there. They like links now. They're very finicky. In a year, it'll be something else, right? It'll be like, I don't know, PDFs. It will not be PDFs, but, you know, but it'll be something else. But for now, you got to get your images, videos, and links up there. Those are really important sources of content. Here are a few more posts. Let's look at them. Who else can translate? Let's look at the one on the left. Yeah, that is a good picture. I want to eat that. And that also did very well. And let's look on the right. There's a picture of zucchinis and carrots. And what does that say?
Who wants free vegetarian recipes? Register.
Right. So who wants free, thank you. Who wants free vegetarian recipes? We'll get into the word vegetariano later, but it can also mean vegan. This group is vegan. Register now at vegetarianobaconvs.org, which is a free vegan email recipe program in Spanish. Say that 3 times fast. Okay? So that's one of my clients. And you'll see these posts are doing really well. Look at the metrics at the bottom. What about these posts do you think made them successful? You asked a question, good. So you'll see, especially, look at the one on the left, which is a real direct question. The one on the right is kind of like a, it's not a real question. It's like, do you want this? Go here, right? But the one on the left is asking people's opinion. Questions are great for the Latino community on social media and really for anyone. People get engaged with questions. They love to be asked their opinions. We all love to be asked our opinions, right? So that got 518 comments. And I'm telling you, people are going back and forth, uvas, fresas, you know, they're really getting into it because they're excited. They're excited about fruit, okay? You know, as you can imagine, if you're a vegan in Latin America, you got to get excited, okay? Because it's a tough situation. So this is like a free digital resource for these people, and they're thrilled. They're thrilled. And so that's why you see that high level of comments, the question. Anything else that stands out to you about these slides?
Well, they're attractive pictures.
Yeah. Bingo. Big thing. They're fun, engaging, colorful pictures.
They fill the screen.
Yeah. You know, the worst thing you want on Facebook is like a teeny tiny picture with a lot of white space. Yeah. No one wants to click on that. I don't know, strawberries and grapes. Right? Good point. Anything else? Yes?
Kind of like, it relates to your home like that.
Mm-hmm. And you're ready to like sit down and eat it, right? Yeah, it's like, it's homey. It's because in Latin America especially, and I think this is probably also true for certain people in the US, you eat with your family. Like here, it's kind of like, I go out, like, am I proud of, sandwich or a salad or Thai food or whatever, but and I might invite friends, but like typically in Latin America, people are eating with their families, and so for these folks who are following an alternative diet that is stigmatized, to feel that sense of hominess, without having to struggle with abuelita about, but I don't eat carne, I don't eat pollo, like, I just need some fruits and veggies, that strikes home for them. Because that's what they're facing. Now we're gonna, I don't know if we'll sing, but we'll chant. Ahora canta. We have three key things that we're gonna learn right now. Audiencia.
Audiencia.
Way louder. Audiencia.
Audiencia.
Lengua.
Lengua.
Cultura.
Cultura.
What does that mean? They look like English. You should all figure this out. Audience, language, culture. These are three key elements of any outreach to the Latino community. In this order specifically. Okay? Here are some examples of an audiencia. 18 to 34-year-old Latinos in the United States. Boom, that was specific. Age, location, group, right? That was very specific. It could be 55 to 70-year-old Latinos in San Antonio. You define an audience. To say you want to reach all Latinos is like saying, oh, I want to reach white people. It's like, what does that mean? You would never say that. You need to get specific. Número dos, lengua. Are you doing it in English? Are you doing it in Spanish? Are you doing it in Spanglish? Are you using some of all three, depending on who you're talking to? You know, it's important to consider that in different countries, and even in different regions of, for example, Mexico, people use different words for the same thing. So, ¿cómo se dice? Avocado. Or?
Guacamole?
No. After. That's for after. That's the best answer ever. palto. Has anyone ever heard palto? It's another word for avocado that they use in other countries in the Caribbean, right? What about fresas? Does anyone know another word for fresas, strawberries? In Argentina? Frutillas. Frutillas. It just sounds like Argentina. Frutillas, right? Which is just another way of saying strawberries, right? But, you know, it differs based on the country and people react to that, which we'll get into the whole fresas and frutillas controversy. 2014. Cultura. So we're going to get into this with the example, but plants and cuisines are different in different countries. Latin America is big. Big. It's like saying European food. It's like, what? What's European food? Okay? Latinos are diverse. Okay? If you go to Argentina, you're not going to see guacamole, sadly. You're not going to see tortillas. No, it's going to be, a lot of beef, right? Because it's beef country. Not tropical fruits, because they don't really have any tropical areas. So the cuisine is very different in different places. And you can apply this to what you're doing, too. This is just for cuisine, but you have to think, where is my audience coming from, right? Like, what messages are going to resonate with them based on their culture? Based on what they know, based on what they're making at home with abuelita, with grandma, right? For example, mangoes. Who associates mangoes with Caribbean or Latino food? I love mangoes, right? Go to Chile and try to find a mango. You won't. It's very, very difficult and very expensive. So, as I'll get to in a little bit, when I was setting up this recipe program promotion with my client, their original thought was like, let's have lots of like Caribbean fruits and flavors and like Mexican ingredients. And you know, people in Chile and Argentina and Uruguay and Bolivia were saying, we don't have mangoes. Send us something without mangoes. So you have to be sensitive to the fact that people come from different places. And in some cases, the cultures are very different. So now we're going to do a quick discussion with your table. I want you to talk about, for your organizations, maybe go like a few, 20, 30 seconds each person. What is your organization's audience? This is the hardest question for any organization to answer sometimes. But as specific as you can get, who is your audience? Vamos. All right, so let's take a few examples. Who is your audience? Volunteer. Who's your audience for your organization?
Nobody.
Okay, back in. Okay. Who else? Yes. That is beautiful. So specific. Love it. Yes.
Girls and parents decided to leave. I'm with Girl Scouts.
Girls, stay there.
And their parents.
Girls and their parents. All right. I'm going to push you. What kind of girls?
Well, I work at the West Side Center, so for me, it's primarily Mexican American girls.
Boom! See, specific, specific, specific. You get rich in the niche. That's what I heard once. Yes.
Our center resides close by to her, so our demographics is primarily Mexican immigrants and Mexican Americans. So we work with two audiences: with our community and then with donors. Mm-hmm. And so I have to put everything out in bilingually if I'm reaching my community, because otherwise I'm going to lose everybody, because the parents primarily are from Mexico that have immigrated here, whether they're legal or illegal. We treat them all the same.
Absolutely. We have one more. Were you all here? Yeah.
Yeah. So ours is not the only
Okay, tell me both.
Yeah, so our current audience digitally is 25 to 40-year-old upper middle class white men.
Okay.
but we're a nonprofit that serves economically disadvantaged ethnic minority students, K-12.
Different audience. This is a great example, because you can know your current audience, but you can also target a different audience, right? So that's what this is about. Who is your audience is not just who you have now, but who you want to be your audience, and then you can build an outreach plan from that. So case study, vegetariano 21 días, okay? ¿Qué significa vegetariano 21 días?
Vegetarian
in 21 days. But let me tell you something, in Spanish, vegano, vegan, is a very new term, and it's not very widely understood, except for vegans, actually. I mean, some people have never heard that phrase before, vegano, right? Which is vegan. So we use the term, my client, vegetariano, because it's more widely accepted, more widely understood. And actually, some people who are vegetarianos in Spanish-speaking countries, but are vegans in practice, still use the word vegetariano, right? So vegetarian or vegan in 21 days, either way. So this is the Facebook page. The likes have gone up. It's now at 420,000 likes. Two boosted posts ever in 3 years. Yes? They're based in D.C. They have programs all around the world, but they're based in D.C. So what is it? So PCRM is the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. That's the name of the nonprofit that sponsors the program. Vegetariano 21 Días is just the name of their Spanish outreach program. Their Spanish, it's a three-week free recipe program in Spanish. Originally when I was brought on to promote this, I did media pitches and we focused on print. And actually we had a lot of success. So even though I'm talking right now primarily about digital outreach, don't neglect your Spanish language newspapers either. Because a lot of cases, first of all, they have great reach in the community and great reputations. And second of all, oftentimes, like any other local paper, they're starving for content. So you have something interesting and well-written in Spanish, it's probably getting in there, right? It's really refreshing after pitching English language media, which is very difficult. Especially in D.C. There's a lot of interest, a lot of willingness to engage. So don't neglect the Spanish language newspapers either. But now we use digital channels. primarily. We have a Facebook page and a blog and a website. And I don't create the recipes, I just help promote the program. So audiencia, right? Audiencia is number one. Originally, this was, you know, before I was brought on to do the promotion, when they were crafting the program, they decided their audience was Mexicans, like in Mexico, and Mexican Americans. However, even with that starting audience, it grew much more diverse. You see on the right all the different, well, these are the top 10 nationalities represented. And you'll see, first of all, Mexico is number one by a lot, but you also, I mean, how diverse is this? Mexico, Argentina, US, Spain, Peru, you have three continents in the top five. And very different cultures. You know, you've got the Andes, you've got right across the border, here, the Mediterranean, and the southern cone of Latin America, of South America, right? So it's grown very, very diverse. So what can happen sometimes is you target a certain audiencia, but it changes. Kind of like what you were getting at. It either changes because of organic change, like this, or because you want it to change. So you have to pay attention to that. Let me just point out how cool this is. Look at the second to last country there with over 11,000 people. Brazil, right? They don't even speak Spanish. But they love our content. Why? First of all, lots of cultural similarities, even if it's a different country. And second of all, Portuguese is very similar to Spanish. So if you speak Portuguese or speak Spanish written, you can understand a lot of it. So they can understand a lot of the recipes. Lengua. So at first, the translators they hired were told to use more Mexican-oriented Spanish, because that was the audience, right? Now, however, going back to the strawberry controversy, you know, originally, fresas was used because it's the most common word in Spanish for strawberries, right? And there was a lot of different dishes with oatmeal and strawberries and all this different stuff. So fresas was everywhere and it was on our social media. The only way we knew this was a problem was social media. Because if you're just sending out emails, it's kind of one way. Right? They're seeing the recipe, they're cooking it, they're not cooking it. There's no real interaction. But when we would post about fresas on social media, on Facebook, we would get the biggest debates. You would have thought this was like, I don't know, like a presidential election. No, son frutillas, no son fresas. You know, it's back and forth, because of this other word in Argentina for strawberries. And you saw Argentina was one of our top countries. Right? So what we decided to do was still use fresas because it's more widely known, but in parentheses, in a little nod to Argentina, we put frutillas. And it really felt, it made people feel represented. Right? That's what they wanted to feel, included. Right? So we didn't have to actually eliminate our use of the other word, but we did need to add to it to make people feel like they were part of this community. People get very intense about language. As you'll see on the right, kind of what I was pointing out about Brazil was that we've now got other Romance language speakers involved because of the similarities in languages. They understand a lot of the content. And maybe there aren't that many Brazilian vegan email recipe programs. So, you know, we got people in Portugal, Brazil, Italian speakers, French, Catalan. I speak Catalan, maybe very excited, which is what they speak in Barcelona. These people are all engaging with the page, which is really awesome, because through Spanish, through our Latino outreach, we unintentionally built a global audience. And I want you to think about that, because I think in a lot of cases, your outreach to Latinos can end up leading your organization. It can end up building new opportunities for your organization that you didn't know existed. It's not a side program. It's not a side program. I want you to try to think of it as a core program because it can lead you to opportunities you did not know existed. We have people in Romania following this page. Romania! I mean, they're following our page because guess what? Romanian is a romance language and they understand a lot of the content and they're excited about it, which made us have to think more about what we're going to do next, right? Cultura! So we talked about this today, but I'm just hammering it home so you really get it and really take it home with you. Because of the mobile issue, images are so important. This is a wonderful image, especially if you pull it up on your phone. It's actually, well, first of all, tell me what it says. Somebody? Yes. So what I do to be kind of fun with the page is I'll take pictures from the internet of different purely vegan photos from markets. Be careful. There are lots of photos with like meat over there, cheese over there. So you have to be very careful. But from marketplaces around the world, and they make the people guess based on the little signs. Those are written in Greek, by the way. This is in Greek. So, and they love to guess 563 comments. People love to engage. The Latino community especially loves to engage. Okay? Now, like I mentioned, because our audience is more diverse now, in terms of national origins, we are now considering new foods, new recipes that apply to different places, that use ingredients from different places, that are easy to access, that are not specific to only one country, to make sure different people have access to that same information. And also that's reflected in the language we use, like I talked about with the fresas and frutillas. We're trying to be more inclusive. We actually came up for the program because of feedback from Facebook where people would say panto, aguacate, fresas, frutillas, like all these different names for the same foods. We actually came up with a dictionary of commonly used ingredients in these recipes in different dialects of Spanish. And so people could see, oh, when they say panto, they mean aguacate, right? And they were able to engage in the program better. And let me just add here, this is fun. Like, if I see a photo like this on Facebook and it's like asking me to guess where this picture was taken, that's cool. Like, if I'm bored at a bus station, I'm definitely participating in this. And what I would do is, like, after like 400 or 500 people have guessed, I would just say, this is it. You know, this is where it was taken. And everyone gets really excited and they like it, right? So it's a game. Make it a game, make it engaging. There's a general rule that I once heard a presentation that I love, which is the broccoli and cheese rule. Anyone ever heard this rule? We saw the broccoli earlier, right? But the broccoli and cheese rule is like, think of broccoli as like serious promotional stuff. And the cheese rule is fun, celebration, engaging, right? This is cheese. I'm not making an ask. I'm sharing something fun and engaging. This is cheese, okay? You should have about 3 gives to an ask. In other words, give a fun photo, give an interesting video, give a picture for Halloween that says, you know, happy Halloween, and then you make an ask, sign up for X program. That should be the ratio. 3 things that you're giving to the people on your page, 1 thing you're asking back. And if it's too much of the asking back, people turn off. They're not interested. They don't want a news bulletin. That's boring. They want fun. Think about what you click on when you're on social media with your friends. Engaging stuff. And if you see a lot of engaging stuff from a friend on social media or elsewhere, and then they ask you a favor, you're much more likely to do it for them than if it's just a steady stream of asks. So now we're going to talk a little bit about advocacy. Okay? We've talked, I'd say our first case study with Mecatagan and Bethune Diaz was, it's a form of advocacy because there are different ways to advocate, by the way. You know, advocacy is not just political, it's not just outreach, it could be fundraising. There's a lot of different ways to advocate for your organization. I'm just trying to teach you the skills. You can apply it to different audiences and different aspects of your organization, but I want you to understand the skills because then you can apply it to whatever you need. So, Mecatagan and Bethune Diaz was specific to the Latino community. It's an outreach program and it's an engagement program. Some of your organizations might be more strongly in the advocacy category, or you might need to sometimes. Maybe the city council is threatening your budget. Maybe the state's threatening your budget. Maybe there's laws being proposed that you need to fight back against and mobilize your community. Maybe it's just as simple as making people aware in your neighborhood, in your community, in the neighborhood you're working in, of a political issue or a conflict that you need to resolve, even among people within your volunteer networks. But the point is, advocacy is really important. Because if you don't advocate for yourself, nobody will. Nobody will. So you gotta learn to stand up for what your organization needs and what you believe. So here's an example of a case study that happened recently. I had this presentation already several weeks ago. This wasn't in it, okay? I called Scott, I said, look, you wanted me to talk advocacy, I have an example. Can I include it? And I ran it by him, he said, absolutely. It's not specific to Latinos, but I think it works for any community that you're reaching out to. Lance Dance. Who is this cute boy? This is my former intern, Lance Sanderson. He is from Memphis, Tennessee. He goes to, well, as of December, he'll be done, which I'll explain later. But he attends the same high school that my partner went to, an all-boys Catholic school in Memphis, Tennessee. He's gay. And he was having a rough time at school. He was being bullied, the administration wasn't doing anything, and because my partner's mom worked at the school, she connected me and Lance, because apparently he was interested in social media. I said, great, you're a good kid, you're interested in social media, come fly out to DC, this was a year ago, and intern for me. Why not? Get you some experience, get you in a new place, progressive place, new experiences, right? So he came out. He came to the school, he's been out of the closet since freshman year of high school. He's now a senior, so this was when he was a junior. He was having a rough time. You could tell he was a good kid, but he was closed off. He wouldn't say thank you for things, he wouldn't engage. He was very tightly wound and clearly anxious because of all the stuff he had been through at school. And so we were very kind to him and welcomed him in and got, you know, introduced him to my family and my friends, and we thought, okay, we did our best. You know, hopefully he'll be okay. He goes back to school, and he kind of improved his attitude a little bit. We kept in touch throughout the year, and we saw him whenever we'd go visit Peter's family in Memphis. So, this past summer, we get a frantic call from Lance. I'm in the car with my partner. And he said, I asked the principal if I could take another boy to the school dance, to the homecoming dance. And he said, first he said, no, I don't think so. And then he proceeded to tell him that gay relationships are violent and unstable. And then he forced him to read an article on the internet about a gay man in Texas, actually, who killed his partner in a very brutal way. Exactly. It's both ridiculous and really sad and horrifying all at the same time. So we're talking him through this. Now, he then like writes back to the principal and says, and he had this in an email, okay, which is like, if you're gonna be bigoted, at least just say it out loud. Like, don't put it in an email, right? Very unstrategic. But okay, he did that. And then we talked him through it, and long story short, the principal said, okay, I'm going to set up a committee to decide if you can bring a boy to the dance. I was like, what century are we in? But okay, fine. He waited patiently for 2 months. Didn't get a response from the committee, didn't get anything. It's a week before homecoming. That Monday, so homecoming was on a Saturday, that Monday, Lance got a message from a friend at school. He was homesick. Over the loudspeaker, they announced that you cannot bring boys from other schools at school. Everyone knew who they were talking about. They put it on their website, and he was humiliated. And I said, Lance, like, what do you want to do, you know? I mean, we had talked months ago about going to the press, but Lance wanted to work within the school, try to pressure, try to advocate for himself, and it didn't work. And I said, look, I'm here for you. I work in communications, you know that, you know social media, but we're not gonna do anything unless you wanna do it. And he said, no, let's do it. Because I think he had pretty much, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. So what happened? You know, the school said you couldn't bring a male date to the dance. What are the goals? There were two goals with this campaign that I was helping him lead. Just pro bono, because I love him. It's my friend, my former intern. One was empower Lance. This kid was sad and isolated. And I wanted him to feel better about himself. Build connections with people. Number two is change the school policies. Bullshit. So what was the twofold strategy with this advocacy? Number one, social media. Big time. I made that hashtag. It's a killer hashtag, right? That's awesome. His name rhymes with dance. Like, what else could you ask for? And so, excuse me, we started reaching out to other social media influencers, people I knew, to get them tweeting about it. Just get the hashtag out there, right? So that when other people learned about the story, they would use the hashtag. Number two, earned media. Who understands the difference between earned media and paid media? Yes. Right, it's media you get that you don't pay anything for. You could put out a press release, you could call a news station, but you're not paying for anything. We put up no ads for this entire campaign. We didn't have a budget, and I don't think we needed one. So we just said, earn media. So again, you know, we're gonna talk about the hashtag. In addition, we did reach out to traditional media. This gets back to my earlier point about Latino newspapers. Social media is crucial, but it can work really well in tandem with traditional media outreach. So don't neglect that. It's still really important. Television, radio, newspapers, it's big. In fact, the only media that really survived the 2008 crash was the Latino media in the United States, right? So it's still there, it's still strong in a way that the English language press is not in the same way. So, in the end, this was a huge social media success. We had thousands, many thousands of tweets and Facebook posts. When I looked back, we were covered by about 150 outlets. Crazy. 150 outlets in Memphis, but also all over the country. CNN, the Austin Statesman. Okay, I was one of Peter's friends lives near Austin. Hey, guess who's covering this? You know, they went to high school together. So it was in Italy, France, UK, okay? All about Lance. So the positive, we destroyed the school when it comes. I mean, sorry to put it that way. I'm not about destroying things, but like, they had it coming. The positive news coverage to the negative news coverage was literally like 98-2. I looked through the articles. There was two negative articles. One was just this random blogger, and one was a letter to the editor. I was like, okay. Because you know what the school did? And this is a lesson, technology-wise, strategy-wise, for any campaign. They did not respond on social media. The one time they tweeted about this was a firestorm. You had, you know, Shonda Rhimes from Scandal. She was tweeting about it. Dan Savage, Dustin Lance Black from Milk. And all these people were tweeting. B.D. Wong, you know, the guy from SVU. So they're all tweeting about it, and the school says nothing. They didn't comment on a single news article. Bad. Good for us, bad for them. So, you know, in a crisis situation of that level, you can't just not respond. Not that I'm giving advice to the school, but to you guys, you can't do that. If it's a little teeny tiny problem, you cannot respond. When they're covering it in the UK, you have to respond. Okay? So what's crazy is, you know, we started with this connection that I had. A childhood friend of mine who works at Mike.com, which is kind of like a sleeker Huffington Post, like a little bit smaller, but also very progressive. We knew we'd get favorable coverage, right? So he connected us with a reporter, they did a story. And then we also reached out to the Memphis Flyer, which is a progressive newspaper in Memphis. We wanted outlets favorable to our message. There's nothing wrong with targeting outlets favorable to your message. If you're a social service agency, you probably want to go to the local progressive paper before Fox News, right? Let's just be honest. You need to think about who you're targeting and why, right? Because you want people who are going to be favorable to the needs of your organization, whatever they are. So, you know, we started with those, and what we did was we then used social media with links to those articles to pitch other outlets. This is like, it's beautiful. It's just wonderful, right? Okay? You can use social media to pitch traditional media. Reporters check their Twitter feeds more often than their emails, right? So think about Twitter not just as a tool for your audience, but as a tool for reaching the press. And so what happened was, with each subsequent story, the next paper would quote the last story. And so it just mushroomed. But I gotta tell you, in addition to the social media part, and we'll get to this later, I picked up the phone. It's like a weird thing for a social media guy to do. I picked up the phone and called newspapers. I said, I have a story for you. I told them the story. I had a pitch written out. A pitch is just kind of like a shorter press release, just kind of a summary of the story. I sent it to them after I talked to them on the phone, and then they covered it. And then they noticed the social media, and it just built. So don't be afraid to pick up the phone, even if you're a social media person. It can help. And social media and the traditional press build off each other. That's what I really learned from this. So everyone get your phones out. There's at least one person at your table on Twitter, hopefully. If not, get on Twitter. It's fun. It's fun. Go to Twitter and just search for Lance Sanderson. His name is up there. Lance Sanderson. You seeing some tweets?
En español.
En español también. Let me ask you a question, because there are two issues. But first of all, I agree with you. And I think some of these lessons will be helpful for that, because we're going to have takeaways at the end for how you can use it for other campaigns. Are you talking about racism from other communities towards Latinos, or racism within the Latino community?
It's a double-edged sword.
Okay. Remind me when we get.
Hard,
yeah.
They're looking at different educational levels, and sometimes they leave those groups and they move on.
Right.
And they don't want to fight that cause anymore.
Right.
They're into progressing.
Right.
In their own.
So how do you keep people engaged?
Exactly.
Engaged. I will come back to that. Feel free to remind me when we come back to the takeaways. I think some of them will be helpful for any campaign, but particularly what you're talking about. Because again, this is just an example, but this is applicable to different campaigns for Latinos' rights, for social services, for healthcare. You need to learn the skills to mobilize, right? So you can be ahead, just like we were ahead of the school. Imagine the school as your competitor, right? But in your case, it's racist.
It's not just racism, but you're talking about the United States politicians.
Right. Well, I think a lot of them are racist, too.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, granted, but
yeah.
It's against a much bigger monster versus that
school. Well, I don't know about that, because actually, this was the whole Catholic Church getting involved. This was when the Pope was in town. It was a very big, it's a very big bureaucracy, so I think there's more similarities there. Because it's not just the school is part of the LaSallian order, So it's a whole order within the Catholic Church. And then there are conflicts between that order and the other orders, because actually this is getting into, I've learned a lot about Catholicism from my partner. But, you know, apparently this particular order doesn't really like the Pope in some cases, right? Because Lance wrote to the school and said, hey, there are schools, there are Catholic schools that have gay straight alliances. Look at this one. There was a New York Times article about it. The Pope said X, Y, and Z about including LGBT people. And the school said, we are not answerable to that authority. Which, I'm Jewish, so I don't fully get it, but I think I get it. That's pretty messed up. Because that's supposed to be the authority. But there's a bureaucracy there, is my point. And so it wasn't just about the school. They were, the bishops of Memphis were getting involved, and it was very complicated. I am going to come back to your point for how to apply this to the Latino community, though. Yes?
You're probably getting there, but what happened?
Okay, we're going to, so you saw the tweets. Now go on Google, because that's the social media side. Go on Google and search for his name. Because, yeah, he is the first Lance Sanderson that pops up. Yes?
How long did it take from when you guys started to, when all of this campaign?
It's hard to say when it ends. I guess it kind of has ended yesterday when I got a text from him. Yeah, oh, sorry. Well, let me... Oh, like a day or two. In some ways an exceptional example, because it's such a charged story that a lot of media are going to cover it. However, I think it's still relevant for less charged situations. But I think the story really told itself in some ways. But within that week, we have over 80 news stories, that first week. Yes. Yeah, so that's the other part. So, this is a strange coincidence. I happened to be in Memphis with Peter the weekend of homecoming, just visiting his family. Like, it was just a coincidence. And it's the same weekend as Memphis Pride, which, if any of you know anything about Pride, they don't usually happen in October, so it's pretty strange. But it all coincided on the same weekend. So what happened? The school said you can't go to the dance. I mean, he could go alone, but he can't go with the boy. He had bought a ticket, but he decided not to go. I contacted the Memphis Pride Parade, and I said, can we march with you? We're not signed up. He said, absolutely. So we marched in the Pride Parade instead of going to the dance. So he didn't even break their rules. Let's be clear. He did not go to the dance with the boy. He could have shown up, and this is where you have to be careful. You know, he could have shown up with a boy and news cameras and really made a big conflict out of it. But he didn't want to do that, because he still values the education he got, and he didn't want to make it worse. So he didn't break the rules. Monday, so he marched in the Pride Parade, got more good press, and then Monday they suspended him. They suspended him. And so, you know, which is terrible, and he's a child, and he didn't do anything wrong, and he sat at home for a week, and long story short is that they were trying to push him out of the school, and they came to an agreement where he is going to, through a third-party online homeschooling provider, finish in December and then go off to other opportunities. He's been getting tweets from celebrities. They want to meet him in LA and take him to this and that. He's gotten all sorts of great job offers before he goes to college. And so he's going to move on with his life. But it was really unfortunate the way the school responded. As a tactical point, and I think this is important for any campaign, and this includes the Latino community, the school, in addition to not commenting on any of the stories, which is a big mistake, and not engaging on social media, except the one time they tweeted at a reporter, and then they took down the tweet, and the reporter said, why did you take down the tweet? Which made its own problem. So, get a hold on your social media, make sure your voice is in the news stories, regardless of what's going on, because silence is not an option. And number three, Number three is don't make the situation worse by expelling the kid. Okay? Because then what happened was there was a whole nother set of articles from all around the world in support of lands. So from a strategic angle, make sure that you're planning ahead and you're thinking things through. Yes? Yes, but not very, they weren't really involved in the outreach. Like, they were broadly supportive, but maybe not, like, as involved directly in, like, they didn't speak to the press. My mom would. But that's my mom, like a Jewish mom. So, there would have been protests, there would have been the ACLU, I mean, the PTA would be involved. So, but I think what was really inspiring about it, even though there was a lot of dark sides to it, was that Lance feels inspired now. And Lance is an activist now, and he wants to speak out, and he's not afraid. And he's a different human being than the kid I met a year ago. He is positive, he is warm, he's grateful, and that to me accomplished goal number one. I think the other point I wanted to get at as far as strategy, in addition to totally neglecting social media and the press, the school's only official response to the entire 2-3 week issue was to put a PDF on their website. Don't do that. I don't care what crisis you're dealing with. Do not respond to a media firestorm by putting a PDF on your website. Don't do it. It's like 20th century stuff. Don't do it. You know, things are searchable. They need to be searchable, easily engaged. You're talking about people and reporters on their mobile phones on the go. They don't want to open a PDF. Don't do it. Make sure that whatever your message is, it's easily accessible to the rest of the world. Yes? They said, okay, so he showed up at school that Monday. The principal pulled him into his office and said, go home. He said, what do you mean, go home? Go home. He said, we'll give you work to do from home. And Lance said, why? He said, I have X amount of other students to worry about. I can't worry about you. So Lance went home and called me. And the school then, once the stories came out, I don't know what they were thinking, like, oh, there's not going to be any news coverage of this. Like, yes, there's going to be news coverage of this. They told Lance, you know, don't talk to the press. Okay, bad chance. They then said to the press, he's not suspended. But then the press said, well, one of the interviewers said, but you sent him home and he can't go on the school grounds, so how is he a student? So anyways, that he ended up going back to school for a day, which they didn't expect after the week suspension. And that's when they finally negotiated. He had to go through a lawyer to get them to even agree to let him finish online. So that's the disappointing part, is the way the school behaved, we can't control. You know, just like if you're dealing with some other sort of prejudice, you can't control the other side. But you can control your side and you can control your message. And we were consistent. You could have summed up our entire campaign in one word, which is fairness. That's it. That's the whole campaign. If you can boil any of your organization's campaigns down to one word like that, you're going to win. I don't care what it is, because you win in the public eye. Fairness. Their explanation for why he couldn't go to the dance, you're going to laugh about this. Boys are not allowed from other schools for logistical reasons. Huh? What's the logistics? What's the logistics? You buy a ticket. But the point is, their message wasn't clear. Their message wasn't clear. Our message was clear. You want to make sure that when you're going out and advocating for your organizations, that your message is simple, easy to understand in whatever language, and clear. And frankly, that it's on the right side of things. Because if you're doing the right thing, it's going to resonate, right? So here are some sample tweets. Well, not sample, they're actual tweets. There's Shonda Rhimes, the creator of Scandal. And you look at the engagement on these tweets, unbelievable, right? And so what Lance is seeing all this, so even as the school was kind of making him feel bad, he's seeing that all these people around the world are supporting him. That's the Huffington Post when they wrote about it. So, you know, we covered the first part. The second part I want to add that this kid, even though the school didn't change the policy, because he marched in the Pride Parade, because he became a public figure, he became kind of a mini celebrity in Memphis. And what that means is other gay kids were reaching out to him. He was now a part of the gay community. He marched in that parade. That was the first parade he's ever been in. I have been telling him for a year, they have a gay community center. Go to the gay community center. Meet some other kids. Don't be so isolated. He wouldn't do it. But now all of a sudden, he has a worldwide community supporting him. And I consider that a huge success. My partner, so this was interesting and I think is also a lesson for your campaigns about allies. Allies. Whether it's fighting racism against Latinos, or racism within the Latino community, or another issue. Allies are very important. My partner is an alum of the school. So what did he do? With a little bit of my help. See, he wasn't on Facebook until this started. Which is kind of nice to be like, since I do this for a living and my partner's not on Facebook, it's kind of just like, it's a nice balance. He started a Facebook group called CBHS, which is the School Pride Alumni. So it's supportive alumni. They got 400 people in that group. And in the group, they're sharing strategies. In the group, they're sharing ideas. In the group, they were talking about press outreach. And several members of the group, including Peter and myself, were interviewed by the local press. And so there's a role, too, for social media for strategy, not just for outreach. Because you can have your own Facebook group that's private, where you can talk about with your community, how you want to move forward. Engage your volunteer base, engage your activists, for whatever the fight is. And so, Facebook is not just for Facebook pages and putting out content. It's also a way for people in many different places to collaborate together on a common goal. And that's what something like a private group can do. So, all of a sudden, this group, which never existed, they don't have any bylaws or anything like that. They didn't have to go through a long process. They made a Facebook group. 400 people. It's quoted in the stories. The members are quoted in the stories. They were interviewed by Fox News in Memphis, believe it or not, in a favorable story. Okay? So the point is, you know, social media can make real change. And you can engage with people who think like you around the country instantaneously. Instantaneously, and in the case of Facebook groups, for free. No budget. There's no budget. Just make a group. Think about it before you make it, then make the group and invite people. Change.org got in on this. How many of you are familiar with Change.org? So, you know, they're a petition site. They saw what was going on social media. They started a petition. It's at 25,000 people plus. And guess what? Petitions as a tool are useful, not in the same way they used to be. It used to be that when you get a petition, let's say a Donald Trump petition. It's like, you want to petition X corporation to not work with Donald Trump anymore. Guess what? They don't care. But, here's the caveat. They don't care about literally having the petition. What they care about is the number of signers quoted in the media. Because let me tell you, no one delivered this petition to the school. They don't give a fill in the blank, mierda, right? They don't care. But what they do care about is that every news story was quoting the number of change.org petition signatures as it got higher and higher to show the public support. So petitions can still be useful, but for a different reason. If you take the same exact content, unedited, and just translate it into Spanish, that's a good step and it's a good intention, but it's not going to work for most things. Some things you do just want directly translated because it's a different audience. And you wouldn't create the same content for a 65-year-old white man in Oklahoma as you would for a 14-year-old black girl in Indiana. And so you shouldn't do it for the Latino community either. If you are going to have translated materials, like for example a brochure, you should make sure that the content of that brochure is specific to the Latino community. It could even just be a few edits, but you need to make sure that you're thinking about the audience for that brochure. And let me tell you, translation is not a volunteer activity. It's not, it's a job. It's a professional job. And just because somebody speaks a language doesn't mean that they have the training to do such a complicated thing. It's an art form. Translation is an art form. You know, I'm a firm believer, I've had arguments with my partner about this before, but I think he's on my side now, just how I like it. Is that if you take a piece of poetry in English and translate it into Spanish, I think it is a new creation. It's a new artistic creation. It's not bad, it's just different. You can't get the same original thing. The sounds are different, the word order is different, the nuance is different. And the same thing goes for a brochure. You know, it's not quite as artistic as poetry, though maybe your brochures are really awesome. But the point is, the same text is not going to resonate, and it'll be clear to a Spanish speaker that it was directly translated instead of crafted for their audience. You know, you wouldn't hand the development department over to an intern, so you shouldn't do it for translation, you shouldn't do it for social media. There's a lot of people out in the nonprofit world, well-intentioned, who think, oh, young people, social media, intern, social media. Well, they may know social media, in which case it's great, but you wouldn't automatically hand over an entire department to someone who's brand new. Any more than you would have that intern going out and approaching big donors by themselves. It's a professional activity, and you need expertise. You need both the digital competency of being able to do social media, mobile, web, all those things, but you also need the cultural competency. Either in the form of one person who has both, you know, for example, the Spanish and the Latino outreach experience and the digital experience, or a team of people who can work together, right? But you can't have just one. Don't just translate your English Facebook post into Spanish, no, no, no. It's like the brochure. You need unique content for that community. We talked about this, good images, links, and videos are king or queen or gender neutral. They're number one. They're number one, right? You gotta have good content or people aren't gonna engage no matter how awesome your issue is. Gotta have good content. Latinos are a diverse community. I hope you've gotten that from this presentation. They're a diverse community by national origin, by language, by education, by income, by location, by so many factors, by race. This is a diverse community. And so do your research on this community before engaging. Know who your audience is. Audiencia, lengua, cultura, right? That's going to be in your head after this, I hope. I hope at like 3 in the morning you wake up and just say it out loud. It might scare your friends and family. So another thing that I hinted at earlier, Latino outreach can lead the way for your organization. It is not a token program. It shouldn't be. It should not just be a side effort. You should think of it as a strategic opportunity to grow your organization in ways you didn't expect. Because that's what happened with PCRM and Vegetariano en 21 Días. Now their Facebook page, it's actually close to 430,000 people, okay? And it's constantly growing. Guess what? It's way bigger than their English page now. No one would have expected that. They're an organization based in DC. I'm the only person, the only consultant for their organization who speaks Spanish. There's one person in-house who speaks Spanish but works in another program area. So they weren't expecting this to balloon into what it did. But it can, and it can for you guys too. So view it as a real opportunity to grow. Latinos are so active on these digital platforms, as we talked about, more active than the rest of the community, more active than the rest of the country. So enjoy it, engage. You'll find that with Latinos, even if you initially have to boost some posts, you will have to boost them less than for your other audiences, because they engage more, and they will help your posts spread farther. And obviously, we learned from the demographic information, this is a large population, especially in San Antonio, but also nationwide and internationally. It's engaged and it's growing. So if you already have Latino outreach programs, grow. And if you don't, get started. Even if it's imperfect, just get started. Do something to start engaging with this community so you don't miss out. You have a question? It goes back to the Audiencia question. The question was whether to make a separate Spanish page on Facebook or multilingual content. Again, it depends on your audience. If it's a Spanish-dominant audience that you're trying to reach, make a separate page. Flat out. Because first of all, unless you are boosting the post specifically to Spanish speakers, a bunch of English speakers are going to see it and be like, what does that say? And then your Spanish speakers aren't necessarily going to see it. So you really need a separate page if you're targeting Spanish-dominant people, because it's not going to reach your audience otherwise. The caveat, I'd say, is if you're making a page geared towards bilingual Latinos, then you may want one page with multilingual content. But if it's just because you want a separate Latino outreach program, make a separate page. Definitely. It doesn't work to do it on an English page. It just doesn't. Advocacy. So these are some of the key messages for any fight. Well, not necessarily any fight, I don't like that word. Sometimes it's a fight. Any advocacy program, sometimes it's a fight. Okay? So let's be real, we're nonprofits, right? Sometimes it's a fight to stand up for what you need. So number one, clarity and simplicity of message. Clear, simple. If you can't sum it up in like three key words, it's not gonna work, right? Like I could say fairness, equality, education. Boom, I didn't even think about it, right? For your cause, whether it's combating racism, what are the three words that you want everyone to think of? That's what you have to think of. What do you want the three words to be that everyone who reads a news story, everyone who engages on Facebook, Twitter, what do you want them to take away about your organization or your cause? Mobilize allies. This is huge. You can't do it by yourself. Whether it's other like-minded organizations, whether it's volunteers in the community, whether it's readers of a publication, whether it's people on Twitter who are interested, for example, in fighting against racism, reach out to those people. Engage them. And engage them before you need them. That's key. If you can. I mean, in the Lance example, it was hard because it was very quickly developing. Right? But if you can, build relationships with those allies beforehand so that when you need to call on that relationship, it doesn't just look like you're asking. Remember, give, 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 ask. Social media and traditional press feed off each other. Big time. It's digital. I mean, most traditional press is digital now. So they're easily interacting with social media. They're quoting people from Twitter, which you couldn't have imagined 10 years ago. I guess Twitter didn't exist, but, a news article quoting what someone posted on social media, but now they do. So they interact with each other, and they can benefit each other. So don't neglect one or the other. Another really important message that I learned, and this was good for the campaign that I was involved in for Lance, is that messages spread so fast these days. It used to be, a 24-hour news cycle? Now it's like, on Twitter, a 5-minute cycle. 5 minutes. Things can go around the world in 5 minutes. And so if you know that, you can craft a strategy that is adept, that's flexible, right? That's engaged, that you're monitoring. Monitor your social media, by the way. Monitor it. Don't just put up a post and let it sit there. Respond to comments that are that need responses and engage people and make sure things aren't blowing up, because you do not want something to blow up in 5 minutes and you just weren't watching your social media. Now, I don't think you need to be sitting at your computer for like 14 hours a day, like staring, waiting for a tweet. No, that's not healthy. Go outside. The weather's nice here. I like hot weather. But you know, you really want to make sure that you are every day at least just checking in on your pages, checking in, what's going on, who's talking. Because you don't want to be caught like this school totally off guard. I think this is important, is that I think you all are, and I've talked to some of you before, you're all working for amazing causes, good causes, helping the community. Let that be a part of your message. The truth and justice of your cause will help it. It will. And so you need to let that come through. Don't sound like a bureaucracy. Talk about how you're helping. Let that morality come through in your communications, because people will respond positively to that, at least the people you want. We talked about this a little bit, pick up the phone. This is more a message for the social media types like me, who are sometimes hesitant to do that. Pick up a phone. Sometimes that can be the best way to build a relationship. Tweeting is great, but sometimes you just need to talk to someone, and you need to work it out and hash it out. And 140 characters is not always enough, surprisingly. This is the most important thing on this slide, I think. That's why I made it all caps. Have a crisis communications plan. Who here either knows what one is or has one? Ooh. Yes, so crisis communications plan is what this school lacked in the example. They did not have a plan for how to respond if a crisis happened. Think about your organization and come up with one or two examples of crises that could happen. And then, even just in a short memo, what are the steps you would take if you had a board member that went to jail? That could happen to any of you guys. Okay? Any of you. Fraud, embezzling, sex scandal, who knows, right? Just be prepared. What are some common things that could happen? Right? What if you had an employee who acted inappropriately in some way that got in the news? How would you handle it? You don't want to be debating that after it's already gotten the news. You're like 10 steps behind. Remember, things move quickly now. So be prepared, have a plan. You will be way less crazed and sleep a lot more when and if a crisis happens. So have a plan. So now we're going to do a very quick role play scenario before we wrap up. With the people at your table, I want you to choose. You ready? An issue, any issue, your choice. Audiencia, lengua, cultura, and then your plan. You got a few minutes, give it a shot. I can't wait to hear all the problems you solved. World hunger, that's a big one. All right, who would like to be a spokesman or woman and tell me a little bit about what their group talked about? Nobody? Yes.
Okay, so we decided to talk about the privacy protection issues in healthcare and education. So we came up with our privacy thing, but our audience is minor. And then our plan came up with this, like,
four-step plan of how we would do a social media campaign on this. So we would take our privacy information in these centers and kind of simplify it down to the third grade level, create and share some infographics to get that information out about, you know, what is privacy and why is it important. And then examples of what could happen if privacy isn't,
So then we decided to share examples of why it's important to keep it safe, why privacy policies exist, kind of not necessarily to scare anybody, but if you don't protect your privacy, if you don't understand these rights, this is what comes of it. And then lastly, information of how our specific entities are helping to keep privacy safe.
Sounds good to me. What do you guys think? Yeah? See some head nods? Good! Thank you. Let's get one more example. Oh, right here? Yeah? That's a good volunteer. Yeah, you, the blue.
All right, our group, first we had the large issue of combating obesity, but then we thought that might be a little bit too big. So we thought, how about combating obesity through access to community gardens? So that's our target and our issue. Our audience, we're going to use an audience of adult Hispanics, 18 and older, and we're hoping for areas that really have a large obesity and a diabetic problem. Then our language would be bilingual because, and we would have two websites because we figured that we would have people that were older and younger that we need to access this. Then our culture, we thought we would rely on traditional family values, especially the value of the family working together to accomplish a goal. And then we would also use San Antonio related values like we love the Spurs and maybe they'll come to our garden and help us. And then our plan. The plan, first of all, we would have a local call to action, and we would do social media, but before that, we might even do door hangers, churches. We thought we'd get the master gardeners to help us and use community center outreach, and perhaps even the lure of contests, and maybe even pumpkins. So that we thought we would need to also educate people somewhat like you did on the value of fresh vegetables, offer recipes and the benefits, and particularly holiday things. So we thought maybe start it and target around a holiday. And then we would be targeting just people in the proximity of the gardens. And one of our ideas was that often the grocery stores aren't available with the fresh fruits. They end up going to Stop and Go or Valero or something and shopping for the fresh fruit there, which isn't too much, maybe an orange and a banana. And then we thought that we would try to involve the whole community and the families with involvement on the work days.
That's great. What does everyone think? Yeah. I'll tell you what I really liked about that was the grassroots component, which works really well with digital, by the way. Because if, for instance, you have people going door to door, putting up flyers or door hangers, take some pictures, put it on Twitter, put it on Instagram, put it on Facebook. They work with each other. Because grassroots outreach really works. It really works, especially with the Latino community. Then get that on your social media platforms too. And it just amplifies it. So that was really great. So thank you guys for that. I hope that was helpful for you. We're going to, you can't see these links very well, but that's okay. They're long and they'll be in your email in a few minutes. Scott's sending the slides out. These are just some resources that I used to get some of the data. Some of you have asked about that. These are some of the websites that I used. And if there's other facts that you want to know where they came from, I have some cards with me. I'm happy to email with you and get you the information. But again, census.gov and Pew Hispanic are really, really great. This is just a pretty picture. Does anyone know where this is? Oh, it's pretty. I might have to go visit that. I can go for a little swim. So lastly, these are some Latino groups in San Antonio. They are not all of them. They are just some of them. Of course, I'm partial to MobDesk because I used to work in their DC office. But these are some groups, if you're looking for partners, if you're looking for allies to reach out to, these would be some organizations to consider reaching out to make headway in reaching out to the Latino community. And I'm sad I'm not here for Fiesta San. Maybe I'll have to come
back.
It's not a Latino thing? But it's still something I want to go to. I'm just sad I'm not going to be here for it. Keep in touch. You know, this is much clearer in the slide deck, but you know, my email's up there, matt@mastrategies.net. My website, my phone number, Twitter, and my LinkedIn. So stay connected. I'm happy to answer questions and be a resource for you. So don't hesitate to be in touch. And I will end it there and just open it up for questions before we wrap up. All right. Did everyone get their questions answered? Yeah. Yeah.
So I have a social media page for my neighborhood because I want to organize my neighborhood. My neighborhood historically, though, is African American, and now there is a large Latino community. And then also with gentrification, there's like Anglo American women. So I want to create a sense of community in that neighborhood, but I don't want to.
Are you talking about like online?
On
social media. I'm gonna talk to you after and give you a specific recommendation, but I think generally if you have a mixed audience and you have some people who are Spanish dominant, I'd make a separate page, is my shorter answer to that. Because people might get frustrated that they don't understand the content from both groups. Yeah. Yes? Starting with the second part first, the older person probably is Spanish dominant, is that right? So that I would craft Spanish content, I would put it on Facebook, but I would also use some of the grassroots outreach strategies that the table behind me was talking about. So if, like, are they in a assisted living facility, maybe, or? What about the hospitals? Like going, can you partner with the hospitals and have volunteers who go to the rooms of Spanish speakers and give them information?
No.
No?
A lot of
patient choice and all of that. But what about staff at the hospital?
We do. We work with hospitals, we're the first staff in hospitals, but particularly people that are not choosing from the hospital, but that are in their home.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say definitely going through the children makes sense because they're going to be more vocal and active. I mean, I would do bilingual because some of them might be more Spanish-speaking, some might be, I would predict that most are bilingual. And they probably speak in Spanish with their parent. So I would have bilingual information of like actual handouts and on social media because in that case you have a bilingual crowd. Right. So I said before, to the previous question, make a separate page, but in this case, it's within a Latino family, I would have bilingual information on social media to make sure you're reaching both. Some posts just in Spanish, some posts just in English, and if it's really crucial for both audiences to know, very short text in both and link to the web pages.
And
yeah.
For the website?
Yes. Yeah, I would. I generally think that's a good idea. Yes?
I just wanted to comment on, or maybe ask a question, on the high percentage of Latinos who are using a phone or a handheld device as opposed to computers. But isn't that just
yes, partially it's that it's less expensive to buy a phone, but you still get internet. So why pay a service provider to bring, you know, plus, I don't know about you, but at least in DC, the cable companies are a real pain. So why bother to pay that when you can just get it through your phone, and it's less expensive? Right, no, so I think you answered your question.
Sure.
Yeah, but I think that's true, that part of the reason for the prevalence of smartphones is because they are less expensive, they're more easily accessible, you still get internet on them. So, and also you can use computers at the library if you're like really gonna type something intense. There's just not as much of a need for laptops as there were 10 years ago.
Okay, so